we wandered over, and lo and behold, there's rugs on the floor, there's a Coca-Cola tent for us to line up for ice cold Coca-Cola, and there's a string quartet and a Parisian opera singer doing Vivaldi as the sun goes down in the middle of the Sahara Desert, you know? And you just, we stood there in our, you know, looking a bit worse for wear at this point because we've only got one more day to go. There's only 350 of us or whatever it was. And it's just one of those real surreal moments, you know? It's like, what the heck?
Kia ora koutou. That was Hazel Harrison. I'm Matt Raymond.
And I'm Eugene Bingham.
This is Dirt Church Radio. Interesting conversations with interesting runners. It's easy to make a silly joke about wild things or whatever and be funny about the ads, but at the moment I think one of the things that we are all craving is community, especially because going out into the wild places is something that some of us can't do at the moment, or we're struggling to. Wild Things has been an established community hub for a long time.
It's like a rock.
It's an institution in Aotearoa trail running. If you use the code DCR2021, you'll get 15 months VIP membership for the price of 12. You get access to all the benefits that Wild Things has, their trail challenges, the shops. What am I missing?
Well, even community, just things like the library.
The library.
You know, I look forward to, because I mean, I like reading about running stuff, and I often think, yeah, I've seen everything, but then I'll get the email with all the latest offerings from the Wild Things library, and it's like, huh, I'd missed that. That's a great read. And of course, we're kind enough to include Dirt Church Radio each week, so if you've missed an episode, you'll see it in there. So there's lots of different advantages you get of being a VIP member, and if you use that code DCR2021, you get 15 months VIP membership for the price of 12.
It's incredible. Please support Rob and his endeavor, and insert silly comment here.
Yeah.
Further Faster has a mega sale.
Du-du-du-du.
It's written in pink neon writing, all capitals, Friday, October 22nd to Saturday the 30th. So as you are listening to this, they'll be midway through their mega sale. They always go off their sales up to 50% off in store and online. They've got like a sample seconds and odds and sods warehouse space that you can come and have a look. My goodness, which is Friday. So, yes, it's right through there. So incredible. If I was in Christchurch, I would be getting in there to have a look at what bargains I could snaffle up. I might actually check out the website, which is furtherfaster.co.nz, and do some more online ordering, which is something I'm getting pretty good at the moment. Please, these guys have been with us for the longest time. Again, you know, amazing community. Please support them, furtherfaster.co.nz.
It goes something like further, faster, there in Christchurch. Rocky is hairy and so is Badger. Jules is nice and Jack is delicious. Go to further, faster now.
Oh, further, faster, there in Christchurch. Rocky is hairy and so is Badger. Jules is nice and Jack is delicious. Go to further, faster now.
Church Radio.
Ngā mihi to episode 165.
Kia ora, tēnā koe. We made it.
We did.
Hey, first of all, you had a last week when we spoke, you had a bit of a mouth issue. She disclosed on the podcast. How did that end for you, Matt?
It ended with a root canal on Wednesday, and I feel incredible.
Yeah,
yeah. So it's done. Good. I mean, it's interesting, right? When we consider our health, and I like to think I'm a reasonably healthy person. One thing that I had neglected was going to the dentist,
right?
And you know, they say you should go over a year. I'd probably put that up by about a decade, but it was one bad thing, which is cool, and I'm lucky for that. I was texting you. I just felt in the midst of all this stuff, just the privilege. And it's kind of weird, but the pain is the pain of privilege because I have the means and the literacy and the access to, you know,
You have to deal with
it. Amount of money. Mm. Yeah, but man, so good.
Mm.
Love not having a dental abscess because, yeah, my face actually was the size of a grapefruit. I looked like I had a stroke. I had like literally had hemiplegia, like half my face was drooping.
Wow.
And yeah, it was gnarly. But anyway, how are you, man?
Yeah, I'm good, man. I haven't had a face abscess. Yeah, it's funny old times, But no, it's been great. And the conversation that we've just had is how amazing. And like you've said, the conversation that we needed, we feel like we're having them every week lately because of lockdown. But Hazel Harrison, by popular demand, really.
By popular demand, yes. The several wild people spoke. Have reached out to us.
The Wild Thing spoke. Hazel Harrison has – we talked about her on the show a couple of weeks back. She's just got back from running Marathon de Saab. Where she was supposed to be going in 2020, but her plans were sort of knocked about first by being diagnosed with melanoma.
Stage 3 melanoma, which is quite significant.
That's serious, yeah. And then of course, 2020 being the dumpster fire that it was. But she was determined to go, and she went and did it this year. And she's just got back, and she's now in MIQ. So she was very, very kind to jump on a call with us.
Absolutely, and what a great conversation! It's much more than the sum of its parts. And if you're thinking, Marathon de Sable, like have a listen to her journey to get there, and actually the attrition rate and the tragedy and everything. It's
a story just that incredible. Has it all. I mean,
it's a story that has it all,
including a string quartet. It's interesting.
including a string quartet. But I mean, you talked about 2020 being a total dumpster fire. It seems like a sort of quite a pastoral, simpler time to me. I mean,
those heady days at this of 2020.
Point, oh, yeah, easy. Oh, sales days. At this point, you know, like people are going, at this point, we'd normally talk about, like, oh, how was your week? The one thing I will say about my week is I am equal parts disgusted in the shape and of my hair, like how my hair looks, and also sort of excited to see where the journey will take me. You know, like I'm resigned to the fact that I want to see how this goes. Man, what a time. How are you going?
Yeah. Well, similarly, you know, my hair is an adventure. It's I don't know, man. I feel like I'm losing the plot a little bit, but anyway.
Oh, I tell you what, though, like I had the most incredible experience yesterday morning. I was standing at my kitchen bench making a coffee, and I looked up, and you've been in my kitchen. You know that I've got French doors all, like one in my kitchen and two in my lounge, one facing out towards the river and one going up the road. And I looked out the French doors, and I could see these two dudes running down the hill. And it was Jean and Harry coming. They were lost, of course, running down through Riverhead. And I literally burst through the French doors and ran down the bottom of my lawn, barefoot in the rain. I was so excited to see them. We had this conversation. Like my property is up on quite a bank, but I was sort of standing above them. I got to catch. I got to see them in the flesh. It was so incredible.
Well, I mean, just those simple joys, isn't it? This morning, I went to do my last big, longer run for this 24-hour race that may or may not happen. And Tom came out for a couple of hours. And I realized that was the first time I'd actually had a face-to-face, safe, social, et cetera, et cetera, chat with a friend for so long. since we ran a couple of weeks ago, but my life has just shrunk. Anyway, we were lucky to have that chat with Hazel. AJW last week was incredible, and of course Tom, who had provided those couple of questions that you asked, was very happy that we'd chatted to AJW. So yeah, we were favorite friends.
That's good to know.
We've got status with Tom, so that was lovely. But should we just get on with it?
Let's do it.
Okay, stuff you should know.
So, I mean, speaking about wahine to us, a strong woman, as is our theme this week. Well, it's an underlying theme through Dirt Church Radio, right? Harita Davies, she's been running the Shriek of Noise Self-Transcendence 3,100 mile race in New York. 3,100 miles. Race in New York for the third time. And as we record this, she's closing in on the finish line for fourth place overall and is expected to finish on Monday night, New York time. Oh, my goodness.
So hopefully by the time we come out, she's already finished. Well, she will be, I think, because of 52 days. But, yeah, amazing, amazing achievement. Amazing.
Yeah.
Incredible. You know, and to have done that three times is absolutely astonishing. You know, we look forward to catching up with her. The race was won by Andrea Marcato, who's a 39-year-old originally from Italy, near Venice. So he finished in 42 days, 17 hours, 38 minutes, and 38 seconds, which is a personal best by over 18 hours.
Not wow. Bad. Oh my gosh.
So he's the third fastest runner in history of that race. And he ran, get this, he ran 30 straight days of 70 plus miles. Unbelievable. And in the last three laps, he overtook the previous third place listed runner by a mere minute and 21 seconds.
It's incredible, isn't it? Like, you think about, I think about Katie and Fiona at the Totowet 100 mile last this year.
Yeah.
And I was going to say last century, and how close that was to overtake a runner on a 3,000.
Oh, no, he didn't overtake the runner.
Race. The time.
He overtook the time. Sorry. Yeah.
Yeah, but overtake the time of the runner by 1 minute.
Yeah.
In 21 seconds. That's
a 3,100 mile race. Oh,
yeah.
Man.
And we talked about Will Hayward last year. I mean, he couldn't be at Biggs. I'm sure we'll be cracking onto that one. But he did in Hong Kong. He was attempting the 4-in-4 challenge, which is four tough Hong Kong trails in consecutive days, a total of 295 kilometers and 14,000 meters. Of elevation, and he only went and bloody did it, and he raised money for the Hong Kong Refugees Charity. And the South China Morning Post said, the Four Trails idea was inspired by the 4-in-4, where runners try to compete the Lantau Hong Kong, Wilson and Mac Lee Ho's trails in four consecutive days over Christmas. It's a low-key sibling event to the Hong Kong's Four Trail Ultra Challenge, where runners try to complete all four trails non-stop. They have 60 hours to become a finisher or 72 hours to become a survivor. Hayward has survived the HK4 TUC twice, and he said, when I did the HK4 TUC at the end of each trail, I came in a broken man, head down, barely able to stand, but in the 4-in-4, I ran the last 6K, he said. I think I enjoyed 80% of the 4-in-4. On the HK4 TUC, I spent 60% feeling terrible. The satisfaction comes from pushing through it in the end, but while I'm doing it, I don't think this is a fantastic time, but in the 4-in-4, I had a great time.
Isn't that so cool?
Incredible.
He couldn't get to Biggs because of the flight restrictions and travel restrictions and so on, but he came up with his own adventure and like you said, went and bloody did it. Well done, Will. All right, we'll do this jingle then, eh? Race
results. Unless you've been living under a rock, you may
Does anyone actually live under a rock? Like, have you ever picked up a rock and gone, oh, sorry?
Sorry, Dandy people. I mean, it's a metaphor, right? But unless you've been...
Right, okay.
Not engaged with social media or running media of any kind over the last week or so. We're here to tell you that Biggs Backyard Ultra was on in Tennessee at Lazarus Lake's house. And if you haven't heard, a new record was set, 85 laps.
Oh, that's 85 hours. You know, Harvey Lewis has finished second twice, well, first loser, in this particular event, and he went in triumph this time. He ran 354 miles, which is 869 kilometres. Wow. He was getting 5 to 10 minute naps during the night, which was a different approach to what he's previously done. He averaged 50 minutes and 18 seconds a lap. So Chris Roberts was the assist. Is that the term you use, assist?
Yep. This yep. assist, yeah.
Yep. And he began the 85th lap and then turned back. He decided he was done, turned back. So Harvey only had to finish that lap to be the winner. Teramichi Morishita of Japan completed 80 laps. He set off on his 81st, which was the previous record held by John Stocker, and was timed out by 30 seconds. He had a fall in that lap two. Those three had run together from lap 63. So,
Says Lewis has broken his hand on a fall in lap 81, but he didn't know about it until he went to hospital when he finished. And he went out and he ran a mile when he got back to Cincinnati at 11 p.m. the next night so he could keep a run streak going. Amazing. And do you know what else he did? He went to work the next day.
He did not.
I read on his – he did. He's a substitute – he's a teacher, a substitute teacher. Oh. And he's like, we're short of teachers and I really want to hang out with the kids. So he went back to work. I need at least 2 years off.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, kids. Turn to page 55. You can start reading.
That's right. human beings, we're incredible.
Amazing, amazing. Well, Will remember had to he'd run longer than he thought he would, and pushed it, got back, and he had to go straight back to work, didn't he?
He did. Man.
Yeah, amazing.
Katie Wright, same thing. She went back to work the day after she won the original. Relapse and then instantly regretted her life choices, I think. Yeah.
Hey, just a couple of other races. So Ruth Croft is racing this weekend. So we're recording this on Sunday. So I'm sure she did amazing. Sophie Grant, Eco Trail, 30 kilometer. How's this? 1,400 meters up, 1,800 meters down. Wow. How would your quads be the next day? She won in 3 hours, 14.
Wow.
And Scotty Hawker, he ran the other week, didn't he?
Yeah, he did. He was second at the Ultra Trail Largo Orta. He's back in MIQ currently. He's in Rotorua. And what a result for an amazing European race season. So
yeah, absolutely.
Awesome times.
Mm. Right.
Greatest run ever, which is the part of the show. You love it, we love it. We ask you to write into us and tell us your greatest run ever. It doesn't have to be a race or the Marathon du Sable. It might just be a run around the block, something that's Harita Davis looking at you. Something that sung to you for some reason. You could send it into us at dirtchurchradio@gmail.com. And just the beautiful thing about greatest runs ever is they span the width and breadth of human experience. So
absolutely.
Just little, this is one of the heavier ones that we've received. However, it is...
it's astonishing.
It's beautiful. This is from Sean Van Bunnock. My greatest run ever is one that started a love for the trails and a tool to fight off depression and other destructive thoughts. 2019 was a horrible year for me, a major anxiety attack with all the pain and confusion that brings, as well as many destructive alcohol-fueled nights and dark places that the hangovers take someone battling with depression. My drinking's always been an escape, something that helped me cope in social situations that make me uncomfortable and helps the real Sean come out. After the end-of-year party, December 2019, that was taken too far by my drinking and a hangover that had me in the darkest place that I wanted to end everything, I decided to go for a run. I drove to the newly constructed Heiara Kotahi Bridge that goes over the Manawatu River and ran. It was very difficult. Hungover, tired, struggling to breathe, I forced myself to go on towards the Linton Military Camp. All this with a heavy heart, tears in my eyes, and feeling deeply ashamed and sorry for myself, I ran into a sprint, running the pain away, or at least trying to. The feeling was incredible. It was truly transformative. I didn't make it all the way to the end of the track, but it didn't matter. It wasn't the goal. I jogged back to my car, no more sprinting, feeling lighter and with a sense of accomplishment. I had new plans, new goals. A small running group was formed, and we committed to at least one run on the weekend. Sometimes that was all we ran for the week, but that was okay. Fast forward to lockdown 2.0. Running has become a big part of my life. I'd formed deeper friendships, met some amazing people, done a couple of really crazy runs I thought I'd never would have been possible, and devoured a whole lot of DCR content. Well, thank you, that's kind. It's a distant third place. I'll always have a relationship with alcohol and anxiety and depression, and I know dark days may slip in again. They did during lockdown. On one grey afternoon, I was in a slump and heading to the supermarket for a few things. Thoughts of stuff everything and everyone pop into my head. It was this point I saw a couple of runners down the street. Stuff running, I said. Well, he doesn't say stuff running, but we're a clean podcast. Stuff running, I said to myself in the car. A smirk appeared on my face. I said it again, inviting running to go and fornicate itself. A goosebump feeling goes down my spine and tears well up in my eyes. Again, he invites running to go do one. He says it quite loudly with a massive smile on his face. I'll always remember that. The thought of turning my back on running was laughable. I know that injuries and setbacks may keep me off the tracks and trails one day, but the beauty and love in the running community and the co-popper that this community honourably live by and preach means that I know I'll be all right supporting my community. But for now, I'm sort of injury free. So let's not think of those thoughts. Ngā mihi, Sean.
Oh, ngā mihi nui, Sean.
Ngā mihi nui, Sean. Thank
amazing.
You,
amazing. Yeah. It can take us on a journey, can't it, running?
It can take us on a journey. And I think it's something that I'm hearing from everyone. I know I'm feeling it. It's that sense of like, you know, you set yourself a certain standard of behavior, of training and being disciplined, and just it's hard. It's the psychological equivalent of doing everything with an oven glove on at the moment, right? It's like everyone is wearing oven gloves trying to play the piano, the only time that would be useful is getting stuff out of the oven. But you know, like it's just super hard, and it's all the better hearing from you, Sean. So
yeah,
carry on,
you,
man. I hope it goes well.
Right. On with the show. Hazel Harrison. So she moved to New Zealand a few years ago after a time in the British Army as a nurse. As you'll hear, Matt celebrates that with arms in the air. She has run since that time in the army and heard of this race called the Marathon to Saab quite some years ago. Set her mind to getting there, but the journey of getting there was quite circuitous. No, what is the word?
Circuitous. Yep.
Yep. And then the race itself was quite the adventure. We've had a delightful chat with Hazel. She's told us all about the highs and lows of this remarkable journey, and you will really, really enjoy this conversation with Hazel Harrison.
Digit Radio.
All right, all the way from MIQ in Christchurch is Hazel Harrison. Hazel, kia ora, welcome to Dirt Church Radio. How are you doing?
Kia ora, guys. Yeah, I'm doing okay with the enforced rest and just getting into a bit of a routine. But yeah, it's good to be back in New Zealand for sure.
Mm-hmm. Oh my goodness. I mean, you've had quite the journey. And for those, you know, there's been lots and lots of people reaching out to us. And I'm sure, you know, you said reaching out to you saying, when are you going to come on Dirt Church Radio? But tell us what you've been up to.
So I flew over to Morocco and took part in the 35th Marathon des Arbres, which, for those that don't know what it's about, it's a multi-stage race across the Sahara Desert, took around in a region of about 250 kilometres, fully self-sufficient. So it was a pretty brutal event this year. It's one that's been put off because of COVID. You know, it was supposed to happen in April 2020, and it didn't. It got deferred four times, and eventually it happened this year, which was a surprise. I never really believed it was going to happen, to be honest with you. It was a case of having to pinch myself that I was, you know, on this journey. It just felt really surreal because at the time when I left New Zealand, we were in lockdown. The airports were quiet. I'd got this extra logistics of dealing with COVID and different tests for different countries. Yeah, so it was a complete different experience traveling during a pandemic.
Yeah. Have you had a chance to reflect on what you've been through? I mean, I guess you've got that enforced rest in MIQ. It's been such a journey. Have you had a chance to kind of sit back and go, whew?
I have, yeah. I've processed it and tried to process it. I mean, it was a brutal event. It was one that surpassed all MDS history for the hottest temperature, the most dropouts. It was brutal. At times it was real pure survival. So I feel a bit like I've had a bit of PTSD in a way,
right,
because of people dying out on the course and processing all the smart, brave decisions I made and just how wonderful the brain is and how wonderful the body is to deal with things like this.
We'll have a good deep dive into the MDS experience, but I wonder if we could just go back to the start and maybe just explain how you got into running in the first place.
Yeah, so I actually got into running because I joined the British Army, and it was a case of in the early 80s, I knew I had to run twice a year to pass this bloody fitness test, so I might as well enjoy it. So I was a track and field runner. And the irony is I used to get bored doing anything more than 800 metres twice around the track would bore me stupid as a young 18-year-old. So I got into running then, and I first read about the Marathon des Sables in 1985, which was the first year it was ever run. And I can remember sitting in my room in the army reading The Runner's World and reading about this crazy race across the Sahara Desert. 17 people took part in it. And I thought, oh, God, one day I'm going to do that. So I popped it on the bucket list and then, you know, and left it there. I knew, I think, that it wasn't the physical fitness that would be the necessary issue. It would be the mental fitness and the resilience to do something like that. So, yeah, I just parked it on the bucket list until, I think, 2018, I decided I'm going to do the 2020 Marathon des Sables, which should be the 35th edition.
It's something... Here we are in 2021, but it's almost like 2020. It's like a post-credit scene, isn't it? But what did you do? I'm interested. What did you do in the British Army?
I was a nurse, actually. Yes, exactly.
For the podcast audience, Matt's got his hands in the air, of course.
So how did that work? You went in and then you did your, I guess it would have been, at that time, it would have been a hospital-based qualification?
Yeah, correct. So I joined up at the age of 18, and I did my, at the time, it was a state-registered nurse qualification, and it was via the Army School of Nursing. So back then, it was, you did 6 weeks, you learnt how to inject into an orange, and off you went.
I went through the training. I started my training 28 years ago, but I'd like to say it's come a long way. It has come a long way, but yeah, there's still a lot of, like, at its fundamentals, it's a simple, not easy. But how long did you stay as a nurse for?
I stayed in the British Army for 12 years, but I actually changed into instructing and teaching probably for the last 5 or 6. So I actually started to teach the Army's paramedics. And then student nurses, and then I went to recruit training. So I became a bit of a, I taught them how to iron and how to march and do all the military stuff as well. So it was, a bit different really.
and that's pretty, we're talking about it a little bit off, but that's, that part of your life is not, it was a definite part of your life. What are you doing now? Are you still involved in healthcare?
No, I was until about 8 years ago. I came to New Zealand in healthcare as a theatre nurse, but now I own a doggy daycare down in Lyle Bay, so a kindy for dogs. I'm also a transformational coach as well and a business mentor.
I guess if you've got that military background and you can mould a bunch of, cadets, you'll be having a cavoodle. Or a bunch of cavoodles or French bulldogs, there'd be no problem. It'd be no factor of difficulty.
No, not much difference, really.
So you're based in Wellington. I mean, it's a pretty incredible trail running city. Or it's a running city, right? Like, it's reductive to just say trail running because it's got an amazing running culture and running history. When you came to Wellington, did you immediately immerse yourself in that, or what was your sort of gateway into the trail running scene?
I didn't immediately immerse myself into it because it was all about trying to just find my feet really in a different country and a different job, etc. But then I didn't have a car, so for me the best way of exploring anywhere was walking or running. So that's what I did. I lived probably about 7K from the hospital, so I'd run into work every day and back again, and then whenever I wanted to explore, I ran. And then I discovered the trails and how beautiful the trails are and how I didn't have to drive anywhere to be able to run in these amazing trails with the great views compared to the UK, where I'd have to drive an hour probably to get it anywhere near a trail. So, in fact, that was one of the main impetuses for me going, now's a good time to do the MDS because training is going to be easier.
It's a great city for that, isn't it? When I lived there, initially I just ran on the roads around Oriental Bay, and they're beautiful places to run. But then when I, you know, connected with some other runners and we'd be running along and they'd go, oh, up here. And it just looked like a little passageway between some houses and suddenly we're on this amazing trail. When you find those little nooks and crannies in Wellington, it's such a great city, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, it is. It's an amazing city for that. Yeah.
So let's get back to MDS. And you mentioned first hearing about it in 1985. But what made you want to do it? What made, you know, I mean, you mentioned that you used to think 800 metres was a long way to go. That's such a massive leap. But what made you go, yeah, that's something I want to do?
I suppose because I didn't find, you know, running halves or marathons or trail running, it's got its own challenges. And I've only ever done single day events, so 100Ks or like the Wu2K or, you know, 80K runs. And I wanted to push the body and see how would I cope doing that day after day after day for 6 days. And then add in the unpredictability of the weather, the hostile environment, the fact that you're having to cook for yourself. You know, you're sleeping on the floor in a tent with seven other people. I wanted to push myself a bit and just test it and just see whether I...
For those who don't know, because there's a wide range of people who listen to Digits Radio, I mean, can you tell us what the race entails? Like, tell us from a structural perspective. And also, it'd be really great, I guess, after that to go over your preparation. But tell us what, for those who don't know, what is the Marathon de Sabah?
So it's a 6-stage multi-stage event. Basically you're living in an 8-person. It's not really a tent. It's just a piece of canvas, and you cover distances from anything from 30 kilometers up to 90 kilometers a day, depending on what they set you in your roadbook. Each and every day you get provided with water, and you get provided with water at the start of the day and at various checkpoints. Everything else you have to carry yourself. You have to carry your sleeping bag, which is mandatory. You have to have at least 2,000 calories of food a day, every day, which doesn't sound like a lot, but it's the weight of it and the volume of it. And you carry everything, and including that is all this mandatory kit, the venom pump, a compass, 10 safety pins. God knows why you need 10 safety pins, but 10 safety pins, you get fined if you haven't got them. And you are literally setting off each day, and you're either running, you know, like I say, 30 kilometres or 40 kilometres or 80 kilometres on a following bearings, following markers, back to a different place every night where you get into your own routine and you get up and you do it all again the following day. And then the following day. And then the day four is a double day. So day four is a mystery day. You don't get your book for that until the night before, and it can be anything between 80 and 100 kilometres. You set off one morning and you get back whenever you've finished it. The cutoffs are quite generous. Some people do just walk it, but they're out the desert a long bloody time if you're walking it. And then the very last day is not timed. It's a charity stage, and it's a 7.5K charity run, which isn't timed. And at the time I thought, God, what a waste of time. I don't want to do 7.5K after I've just done 240K. What's fun about that? But you know, it's a time where you walk as a tent and you talk as a tent and you share some of your deepest and darkest moments when you're doing that 7.5K back.
So, you know, like, and for those who didn't catch where it is, I guess the two words stand out, and there's a venom pump. What? I mean, it's in the Sahara Desert, right? It's in the Moroccan Sahara. What do you need what's going to bite you? What do you need a venom pump for?
Well, apparently there are snakes that are pretty deadly. Luckily, I didn't see any, and scorpions. So the tent next door had a scorpion come and visit them one night. We had a camel spider come and visit our tent. And they're quite big, and they're fast because they want to be in the shade. So they come to your shadow, but you feel like they're running towards you. So, So out on the dunes, there was visible slither marks from snakes. You could see that there'd been a snake there, but thankfully it wasn't there anymore.
I could see how that whole camel spider thing would be a vicious cycle, like yes. An escalating vicious cycle. You're trying to get away, it's trying to get into shadow. Oh, yeah. Goodness me. Yeah. Wow. And so do you get a choice of who you're billeted with in the tent? Is it something, or it's just a complete bunch of randos from around the world?
That's a good question. Yeah, it can be just a complete bunch of randos. Normally they put the New Zealanders with the Aussies. Because there was no Australians went because they weren't allowed to travel, and I was the only New Zealander, I was a bit concerned that maybe I'd be put, only because of the experience, that I'd be put with people where English wasn't their first language. Because the tent life and the end of the day and the sharing of stories is really a huge part of the MDS. So I actually reached out on one of the Facebook pages to see if anybody else was travelling alone or had space in their tent. And I hooked up with a British married couple who... we're looking for tent mates. And then we ended up having a tent. There was eight of us, seven of them were Brits and me. But none of them had brought their Union Jack, so the Kiwi flag was flying the whole time. So
it was nice.
I told them it had the Jack on it, so they'd be all right.
Yeah, that's the thing. It's somewhere on there. So, I mean, you have this idea, you know, you want to run this, and, you know, people say you can't beat Wellington on a good day, right? But I think Morocco, Wellington, Sahara Desert, South Coast, you know, they don't really marry up. How does one prepare in a city such as Wellington or anywhere in Aotearoa, I guess, for something like the MDS?
So when it was supposed to happen in April, it's not too bad because it's coming out of the Kiwi summer. You know, I know it's not a Moroccan summer, but it's a summer, you know. And so training up to when the event got cancelled in the first time around, I was wearing polyprops and everything during the hot runs. I booked into a heat chamber at just Wellington Hospital. I've got a heat chamber as part of Otago University. So I booked in there and I'd done a couple of sessions in there with the heat and the humidity. So I was trying to acclimatise my body to a bit of heat. Then it got cancelled. Then it got moved and it moved and moved. And then it was October. And it's like, how am I going to prepare for this coming out of a Kiwi winter? So I booked into the chamber again, but COVID hit. The chamber, I wasn't allowed to use the chamber. Saunas weren't open. I was like, oh, God. So the next best thing is heat immersion. So I thought, okay, I'll go for a run. I'll get hot and sweaty and then I'll jump in the spa pool. The problem was it was too bloody cold. I wasn't getting hot and sweaty on my run to jump in the spa pool. So heat prep wasn't the best it could be. But I don't know. I think I had an expectation of how hot it was going to be. So I'd got that set in my head for the first day anyway.
Yeah. What about when I think desert and the dunes, I think sand and that sort of thing. How did you cope with the terrain and were you able to prepare for that in any way?
So as part of my initial prep, I did the Surf Coast Sanctuary over in Anglesey in Australia. And the first 22 kilometres of that is on sand. So that was my prep for running on sand. And also anywhere I could run on like pine needles is a similar... It's a similar surface to run on, and just adapting my running style. So rather than pushing off and using the quads, actually lifting pushing off with the calves, lifting the quads up more, and having a different gait. But none of that really prepares you for the Sahara Dunes, far out. Because you know it's not just sand. There's sand. There's rocks. There's dry riverbeds, which are and dry lakes, which are like the most hostile environment. I felt like I was on a planet somewhere else. It was pretty grim. So, yeah, it's difficult to actually train for. The main thing for me was trying to keep the sand out of the trainers. So you have gaiters on. So you have these special gaiters sewn on that are then stuck on with Velcro over your top of your shoes. And I never got any sand in my shoes at all.
Yeah. Oh, great. Well, that must be a magnificent thing to achieve in itself. And so the Is it just on? Just one more question on the terrain. But is it just sparse? Like, do you see anything all day when you're out there, or do you encounter people? What's that like?
Yeah, so on the very first day, it's the easy day. So I think it was 30.2 kilometres. And it's a bit of a day to give you an experience of the different sort of terrains you'll be running on. And about halfway through that, you run through a village. So literally, you're running along, nothing's there. There's the odd donkey. There's the odd, you know, tree. There's the odd spiky bush thing. And then suddenly, there's these four or five houses. And they're made out of red sandstone. And then suddenly there's about six kids running up to you, wanting to high-five you, and they're all smiley and really happy, but they just want food. So they're asking for food. So, yeah, periodically you'd come across a settlement in the first 2 days, but then after that it was mainly just the dunes.
Right, yeah. So you, and you talk about this as much as you want to, but you were preparing to go in 2019. And then health got in the way. Do you want to tell us about that?
Yeah. So I was preparing to go and everything was ticking along really nicely. And in October 2019, I had a mole removed off my left shoulder. At the time, the doctor said it's probably just basal cell carcinoma. I thought nothing of it, went off and ran the Able Tasman track as training, came back and had a phone call from him and he said, Hazel, I'm really sorry, it's melanoma and it's not good. So I actually had stage 3 melanoma. So I had to have that removed in hospital and ended up with a scar from top of my shoulder to under my armpit. So luckily I didn't need to have any chemo or anything like that. And I didn't have to have a skin graft, which was a real godsend because of the healing process. I mean, I managed to negotiate 3 weeks off running rather than a month off running with the doctor, because I needed to get out there, because at this point it was only, the event was supposed to be happening in April, and you know, and I was having to wear a backpack and I needed to test it. So, but at no point was I not going to be doing it. So yeah, that was, oh, I'm going to do this still. And so I cracked on with the training. But then it wasn't that stopped me, was it? It was bloody COVID that did it. So, and they didn't cancel this until 3 weeks out from the event. So it was really horrible because you're watching the news and everything and seeing that the world had gone crazy, if you like, and just waiting for that email, because I couldn't cancel my trip myself because I would lose the money, just waiting for them to cancel it, and then got the email from them. And although I expected it, it took the legs off me, you know. It took the legs off me because this was a whole year of training that, and the melanoma, and then they weren't going to do it. And it was... Yeah, I sat down and I cried and I grieved. I grieved for the fact that this event had been taken away from me. They'd rescheduled it for the that September, so you had to keep training. You had to keep focused. You had to, you know, keep digging deep and believe, even though you didn't really believe, but believe it was going to happen. And again, they cancelled it 6 weeks out. And it was then April 2021, and you're like, oh, yeah, really? But they cancelled it out from the Christmas. So that gave us a good time. So I basically, when they cancelled in January, I put all my MDS stuff in two plastic boxes and I took them around the garage, and I had a month of not thinking about it because I was over it. I was over the keeping mentally focused and training.
Just mentally exhausted as much as anything.
Yeah. So I said, no, I'm just going to have a bit of a break from it. We did get the opportunity to defer, but I'm stubborn, I set in my head I was doing the 35th MDS, so I was going to do it whenever it happened.
I just think about your poor doctor. You're like the holy trinity of terrible patient. You're a nurse. You've got an army background and you're an ultra marathon runner. You're like, no, we won't be doing a month. No, we're not. That's the first thing that strikes me. What an amazing thing to do, to have the discipline to keep doing it, but also the discipline to actually, like you said, put it in a couple of plastic bags and put it in the garage and say, right, I'm going to give it a month and I'm just going to get on with my life and sort of keep training, and what happens, happens, hey?
Absolutely, yeah. I forgot to mention something. When it got cancelled in the, this is quite important actually, I think, when it got cancelled in the March, because I was at my peak, we'd all just started our peak week. You know, this was like training was at a peak. And thankfully, I got invited to come down to Christchurch to do the Unity Ultra, which was a 51-mile event for the mosque victims. And Kieran Goss, whose aunt died in it, he was one of the organisers. So I actually came down and took part in that, which happened on the Sunday before the country went down into lockdown the following week. And that was a really important event for me to do, to get rid of some of that emotion, you know. It was only 10 of us that ended up doing it. It was such a special event to do. And it's almost like full circle, because I stayed in the Novotel that night. So it's like I've come back now and I'm staying in the Novotel. So it's...
And I guess this is the thing, isn't it? You're in managed isolation because you've come back, and when, just before we started recording, you know, you were talking about the fact that there's almost some sort of acute traumatic stress from the whole process, as amazing and as meaningful as it was. I mean, what was it like to actually, the first day, you know, you get there and you're lining up, and what was that like?
First of all, the heat was really strange. It wasn't a searing on your skin heat. It felt to me like it was heating me up from the insides. So it felt like like your nostril hairs are singeing, and you just feel like you're heating up from the insides. There was this palpable tension amongst the only 672 of us. That's all there was that lined up this year. There was a palpable tension of that. Could we really believe this was happening? You know, that it had supposed to happen 18 months ago. So there was that. Oh my God, we're here. We're really here, and we're really going to do it. And it was, at that internal dialogue that's going on about, you know, you've trained for this. This is, you know, this is what you've trained for, and you're going to get the chance to tick it off. So it was. It was very surreal because most of the competitors were supposed to do it in 2020, so we've all come on this journey together.
So when you do arrive, I mean, what are the logistics? What are you carrying? Like, are you said you got your sleeping bag. I mean, how deep down the MDS rabbit hole of gear did you go?
Oh, I went deep. I went pretty deep. I'm a bit of a researcher, and I wanted to get as light as I could to a particular level. So when you first arrive there, your first day and a half, you're in the desert, it's literally you're catered for, and you're getting to know your tent mates. And then that's on the first afternoon. And then the second day is technical day. So you've got your suitcase with you and you've got your kit. And this is the time you can make those last minute calls. You've had one night in the desert. You can go, oh, do I need this? Do I need my fluffy? Do I need compression tights? And you can make some decisions. So there's a lot of to-ing and fro-ing mentally there. You're going, okay, it's hot. It was hot last night. I don't need this. I don't need that. And then you've got your pack, and your pack's got all your food in it for the seven days food. You've got your sleeping bag. I had a stove. I decided not, although I trained with poles, I decided not to take them. I'd got my camp kit. So I'd got a pair of sliders, sandals to put on to let my feet air. I'd got a lightweight T-shirt, lightweight pair of shorts. You know, the bare minimum of toiletries, you know. I mean, bare minimum of toiletries, but lots of hand sanitizer. You know, we're in the middle of the Sahara Desert, for God's sake. And that's where a lot of people fell down, I think. So, and then that day you take all your stuff, you hand your suitcase in, and that's it. Decisions are made. You've got to live with them. And they weigh your bag. And this is the moment of truth, because you want to get your bag as light as you can, but you want to have all the stuff. You know, I had good quality food, good quality dehydrated food, and I knew it was on the heavy side. So my bag actually weighed 9.5 kg before water. So then imagine then the morning I set off, I've got at least a kilo and a half of water. So it's 11 kg on that first day.
And if you don't, I mean, what's approximately how that's like probably quite a percentage of your body weight, because you don't look, unless you're 8 foot tall on the Zoom, you know, like, I don't, you know, yeah, you're so, not like a large individual.
No. So my starting weight, because that wasn't my finishing weight. My starting weight was 55 kg. So,
wow.
So yeah.
So it's a fifth of your body weight again.
Yeah, so your pack, the minimum your pack can weigh is 6.5, and the maximum is 15. So 9.5, you know, I had a few luxuries. I had a sleeping mat, you know, and I, because I think rest and recovery is really important, you know, especially at my age as well. I think it's important that I have a good night's sleep. It was important that I have good quality food. So I was quite happy with the 9.5, okay, knowing that every day it's going to get lighter because I'm eating.
Yeah. But, you know. Talk us through the food. I remember talking to someone for a print article and they happened to be sharing that they had mailed back Hazel and Vajan Armstrong, who, you know, super fast, super light, super minimal, but every night they were like the camp vultures sort of sifting around, you know, hungry and skinny, getting hungrier and skinnier as the event go on. What were you eating? What was fueling you?
So I didn't fancy half of what I took with me. I'll tell you that now. So I use a company called Radix, which is a New Zealand company. So I reused Radix food. So tried and tested, happy with it. So I had Radix breakfast, 600 calorie breakfast. And then I had my race snacks, which were Clif nut butter bars, Goo chews, and Clif chews, macadamia nuts. And I had this great idea that when I got in, I'd fancy something really salty. So I took a cup of soup and then I had the Radix evening meal. And that was about it. Reality. Day one, got the breakfast down. I'm not a breakfast eater every day. Eating your race snacks, forget it. You know, first day was 45 degrees. A Clif nut butter bar at 45 degrees.
I love those things. They're delicious. But, man, yeah, in the drop it in the sand. Come on.
You know, and just the texture of it had all changed and the trying to get it down. So, you know, I had to make some smart decisions, reference my hydration, because I use precision hydration and I use some that are just electrolytes and I also have the powders that have got carbs in as well. So I had to switch out and have more with carbs in to give me that energy. When I got back to camp, I didn't fancy hardly anything. The macadamia nuts were a godsend. High calorie, salty, low in weight. Cup of soup, forget it. Nah, couldn't be bothered to put the stove on. And in the end, I actually ditched my stove and just used the sun to cook my food.
Wow. I mean, wow. Sort of doesn't sound exactly very appetizing, does it? But warm electrolyte and carbohydrate drinks and, sort of, I guess, sticky nut butter bars, but you were finally there and you were running. Was that, you know, when, once you finally got going, was it everything you kind of dreamed of? Was it, you know,
absolutely.
How did it compare to this imagined adventure that you'd had for so long?
Yeah. I mean, the first day it ticked all the boxes apart from there was only 672 of us. And that got less and less each day. But the atmosphere on day one was amazing. The helicopters up, you know, Patrick's all excited, giving us all the brief, getting us all, you know, we sang happy birthday, whose birthday it was, and off you go. And when you first go off, you're all like sort of together and then it splits up as it does with the elites and then, you know, then the amateur elites, if you like, and then middle of the pack and then your back of the pack. And then, so it's not long before you're then actually on your own. And, you know, and I'm the first 13K on the first day, I was running and it felt really good. And I was like, God, I'm in the Sahara Desert. This is amazing. The first checkpoint was 13K away. And I thought, it is hot. And it was a dry wind. And I drink to thirst, but roughly every 10 minutes I'm sipping. And that's my regime. But I thought, hang on a minute, I'm drinking more because my body was thinking I was thirsty because this wind was drying my lips out. So much so that I thought, gosh, I'm not sure I'm going to get to the first checkpoint without running out of water. So then I had to be really, really strict. So that was really scary, you know, the fact of, shit, I can't run out of water. Just that experience of actually being out there and talking to people as you pass them and appreciating how hot it was. My plan was always, the first 3 days was to respect the desert, respect the terrain, get to know it, you know, and then see how you feel after that, whether you're going to push it. Because I'm an age group runner. I wanted to place in my age group, but I do it sensibly. So it's about just feeling it, what it felt like. So on the first day, when we finished, somebody said, it was 45 degrees. I thought, okay. And they said, that's above average for this time of year. And that's from then on, it then all went a bit pear-shaped for some people in the event, to be honest.
And you mentioned at the start of our chat that, you know, you had to make some decisions and you had to, I guess, survival comes into it really, in making those calls. Do you want to talk about some of those?
Yeah, so the first day wasn't too bad, but the second day was pretty brutal. So the second day we actually did 13 kilometres across the majestic Mazuga dunes in the Sahara, which are the tallest dunes. And so it's 13K of that. And they're beautiful, they're brutally beautiful. There was one checkpoint at the beginning and one checkpoint at the end. The mercury on the thermometers were getting up to like 55 degrees. And it was a case of, right, okay, we've got salt tablets and we've been told to take 20 salt tablets a day. We've been told how we should, and I never run with salt tablets normally because obviously there's no need to run with salt tablets in New Zealand. But it was being regimented for me. It was about, okay, you need to take salt tablets. So I literally every hour on the half hour, I took my two salt tablets religiously. About 8K into the dunes, I started to overtake a lot of people. A lot of people were stopping. A lot of people were stopping and putting their emergency blankets up to create some shade. We're vomiting on the side of the track. We're looking pretty rough. I mean, there are 4x4s wandering around all the time, so people were dealing with them. But it was like, God, it is really, really hot. It's searing, but it was beautiful. Got to the first checkpoint, and it was like a war zone. There were people on drips everywhere. You know, there was people with intravenous fluids everywhere. And you sort of take it in and go, because I knew sometimes I'd heard that sometimes people get IV fluids because they get dehydrated. So I thought, okay. And then carried on. So there were two checkpoints that day, and it wasn't until we got back in and heard that somebody had actually, first of all, there'd been a cardiac arrest. That's all we got told. There'd been two cardiac arrests out in the dunes. Back at camp, there was lots of people on drips in the medical tents. There were people vomiting everywhere. It was pretty brutal. It was, you know, it wasn't a nice place, a nice environment to be in. I didn't feel too hot. I felt like I was carrying a lot of fluid because the salt tablets were doing their job. I'd only peed, I think I drank 13 litres of water that day. I'd peed twice during the day, but I felt really, really hydrated and good. But it was about, you know when you're running and you're running in a one-day event and your brain will go into ultra mode, eh? You know, you go and you run and you can run all day at this. And every now and then the governor in the brain will say, I need to stop because you're going to kill yourself. So you confuse it, eh? You stop, you walk for a bit and then you run for a bit. My brain wouldn't let me get into ultra mode and I was getting so annoyed with it. It just kept telling me to stop for a walk. So I had to stop and walk and stop and walk. But on reflection, it's because it was going, hey, Hazel, you've got to do this again and again and again. You know, so I respected my brain and just respected that, okay, I need to speed walk for a bit and then jog for a walk bit. And so that was part of those tough decisions making, you know, that, you know, I want to run, but actually my brain's not letting me do that and for a reason.
It must have been really jarring. I mean, I think, you know, a lot of what we do, it's the pain of privilege, right? Like we pay to tax our bodies and probably tax ourselves psychologically in a very controlled environment where unless something goes totally pear-shaped, we're probably going to be okay end of the day. You know, everyone like, oh, blister, yeah, torn hammy, whatever. You know, like an environment like that, 50, you know, you're saying 45 degrees, 50 degrees, people, the insult to your body is so severe. That must have been really jarring to seeing people having, you know, cardiac arrests. Someone passed away. Was it on that day, if you don't mind?
Yeah, so we got a message at 7 o'clock that evening to all come into the centre of the bivouac because the tents are laid up in two circles, an inner circle and outer circle, and the middle of it is where they do some of the group announcements, if you like, and the water thing and that. So Patrick got us all there really quickly, and we just, the tension was, there was obviously something had happened and we didn't know. There was rumours of, you know, cardiac arrests or whatever, and we stood there and he was really quite upset and he said that he just wanted to let us all know that a fellow runner had passed in the middle of the dunes. And this guy was 53, an ultra runner, got no cardiac history, because our ECGs are checked. You know, we have to submit an ECG on that technical day, which gets signed off. A doctor at home has to sign off that we're fit. He got no cardiac history, but he just had to have a cardiac episode on that day. 45 minutes, they tried to revive him, and the helicopter came and took him away and took him to the hospital, but unfortunately he was... he was, you know, was pronounced dead. So it was very somber. And I was hoping that it would give some people a wake-up call, because there were some people out there, and this is purely my opinion, that weren't respecting the desert, that we're not respecting the environment. We're not used to, we're marathon runners and good marathon runners, but we're not used to running those ultras where we have to change our game on the move, you know? And I think that was a big difference, was that people didn't respect the desert. They hadn't looked after their hygiene because there's lots of diarrhea and vomiting, and they exposed themselves to the heat and didn't adjust their exertion level. So I was hoping that this would be a wake-up call for people to, this is serious, you know, this is life or death out there.
And I'm guessing by your sort of tone, some people probably took that on board, some people didn't.
Mm.
I mean, you say as well, and you know, with that famous double day, you weren't even sure that you were going to make it there yourself. What was happening for you at that point?
Yeah, so when I came in from the third day, which was 37 and a half kilometres, the next day after that was the double day, and we knew it was 82.5 kilometres. So I came in and I had a routine, because I'm very ritualistic, very routine type of person, because it grounds me. So I had the same routine every night I came in from camp, which was, you know, take all my running kit off, wash it, put some camp kit on, get my food ready, all of that sort of thing. I came into camp on that day and I got my, I was about the fourth person in our tent back, and I got my recovery shake and I made my recovery shake up. And then I normally take that and sent my email, my race report back for to be distributed. So I had to force my recovery shake down. I just felt hot. I felt internally hot, and I felt like I'd maybe a little bit of a heat exposure here. So I forced this down. So this was 280 calories of recovery drink. I managed to force it down. I did my email. I came back to the tent and I said to my team, I don't feel too good. I'm just going to get in my bag. I'm going to have my electrolytes, and I'm going to just sip some electrolytes through the night and just see. I felt really nauseous. About midnight, I had severe diarrhea. I had severe cramps in my stomach. I got up about three or four times in the night. And I was, at this point, I'm going, shit, you know. I think I was six in the age group at this point, and I was thinking, I don't know if I'm going to make the next day. I don't really know if when I get up in the morning, I'm going to be able to do this. So in the morning, I got up, tried to get up a bit earlier than everybody else. I wanted to try and force some breakfast down. So I tried to, and it was like, not a chance. Although I hadn't been sick, I felt really nauseous. And I thought, I don't know, if I go off and run on my own like I have been, because I'd run most of it on my own, what if I crash? What if, and that happens in the desert, how irresponsible is that, you know, knowing I've had only 280 calories? So I decided to make a brave call, and I said to my two of my tent mates who I knew were walking it, walking and running, can I go with you guys today? Because actually I don't think I can do this on my own. And that was prompted because my partner gave me notes to open every night, which was really quite nice. And I hadn't opened my third night one. I opened it in that morning. And that note said to me, it said, don't be afraid to reach out for people for help today. You know, you would help other people. So if you need it, reach out. And I thought, oh, my God, that's gives me validation. And that just goes, yeah, actually, this is the right thing to do, you know. So, so I did the double day with Kim and Ali, a married couple from the UK. And we just chatted and it was quite nice. You know, I decided that it would be what it would be. Halfway through, they said, oh, Hazel, you're good. You just go. And I said, no, we started together. We finished together. And that's what I did during the double day. And to be honest, it didn't affect my placing. I think I was still placed fifth or sixth at the end of it, of that day. But it was one of those, I had to make a brave and smart decision for me.
Mm. So have the wherewithal to know that. And what a prescient note from your partner.
Mm.
Wow.
Yeah.
Again, running against the nurse ultra runner army. Like, don't be afraid to reach out.
Yeah. But how was that? I mean, you know, to get that done, you must have felt like I'm there, but you've still got another big day ahead of you the next day.
Yeah. To be honest, when you got to that stage and you were, because I think let me just check my notes. There was only, at the start of the double day, there was only 399 of us. So we'd lost nearly 50% of the field through through dehydration, diarrhea, vomiting, not making the cutoffs, you know. So, you know, so when we finished that, and I finished at 6 a.m. in the morning, and I can remember being really pleased it was 6 a.m. in the morning, because that meant it was 6 p.m. in New Zealand time, so people had been watching my dot. And I had so many messages from Wild Things. It was unbelievable, overwhelming and unbelievable. And then it made me go, you know what? You've only got a marathon tomorrow. Just a marathon, you know, that's it. And you just do a marathon and then you've done it. So at that point, I allowed myself to go, yeah, you can do this. This is in the bag now.
And you've mentioned those race reports, and back home we were all reading them, and Kate Shave was doing a great job posting them and keeping us all informed. And one of them intrigued me. You said there was a string quartet in the desert. What?
So on the double day, I think the cutoff, because the cutoffs were quite generous, I think it was something like the cutoff was 6 p.m. that night. So I came in 6 a.m. in that morning, like 12 hours before the cutoff. And that so most people got their heads down, and we did foot care and we looked after each other. And then at 6:30 p.m., we sat in the tent getting our food ready. And then somebody said, there's a Coca-Cola tent. We're like, what? There's a Coca-Cola tent? And then somebody said, isn't that live music? So we all came out of our tent. By this time, we only had six because we lost two from our tent. And we wandered over. And lo and behold, there's rugs on the floor, there's a Coca-Cola tent for us to line up for ice cold Coca-Cola, and there's a string quartet and a Parisian opera singer doing Vivaldi as the sun goes down in the middle of the Sahara Desert, you know? And we stood there in our, you know, looking a bit worse for wear at this point because we've only got one more day to go. There's only 350 of us or whatever it was. And it's just one of those real surreal moments, you know? It's like, what the heck? You know, what's going on? But just, again, a moment of real simplicity and real, there was a real moment of calmness across the camp at this stage, because most of the diarrhoea and vomiting had stopped and most of the people that were ill had gone home. So now there was just calmness. And what was really sweet is that they did the song that Kim and Ali, the married couple, had walked down the aisle to. It was like, oh my God. So yeah, unbelievable. Yeah.
Speaking of surreal moments, what was it like running through the desert at night? Oh. I mean, how many people can say that they've done that?
Yeah, that was. So there's no background track to the desert. There's no noise. There's no birds. There's no nothing, you know? So it's really a really eerie atmosphere anyway. Then put that with the shroud of darkness. And normally the double day is done with a full moon. Because of October or whatever, we had no moon. So it's really dark and really disorientating. And you're looking, we've got glow sticks attached to our backpacks at this point. So you're looking for glow sticks and you're trying to make sure you can see a glow stick so that you know where you're bloody going. But it's just really... very quiet, very, you have this feeling of vastness. You've got this feeling that you're just this little person in this huge, huge expanse of space. And it's really disorientating because when you can see the checkpoint and you can see the lights, you can see the checkpoint for maybe one of the checkpoints we can see for maybe, I don't know, 7K out. And it doesn't seem to get any closer because there's nothing to gauge the distance on. And it's like a mirage, and you've gone like 5K and you're like, God, it's not any closer. It's not any closer. And then suddenly it's there. So it's lots of, it's a real humbling experience, I think, to be in that hostile, raw environment, you know, full stop. But at night, it just amplifies it, I think.
You get it at 6 o'clock, and then you've got you get the marathon done. Mm. I mean, how was that feeling, like knowing that you had the next day, you had 7.5K to run? What were you feeling at that point?
So when we all got, because the ritual normally was when we all got back to our tents and everybody was in, and we were happy that everybody was in, because that was something you never knew if everybody was going to come back in. And we'd made a decision on day one as a tent that, for that 7.5K, we were going to walk it as a tent. We wanted to, as a tent, walk it. So first of all, you're given a clean T-shirt because they give you this bright yellow charity T-shirt. So you feel like you're dressed up and you've got to go because you've got this lovely smelling clean T-shirt on. And you just, we just started walking. And what we did as a tent is we swapped around walking partners and we chatted and, you know, you got to know more about each other. We knew quite a lot about each other anyway. You know, you make friends for life doing something like this. But just chatting and talking about, you know, what we've been through and then, you know, get having a reunion, you know, we need to have a 1060 reunion. I said, yeah, well, you need to come to do Tarawera, you know, because I'm not coming back over here. So just having a bit of normal chatter. What's really interesting is because everybody's in survival mode, you know, people's little nuances that maybe get on your nerves, they're not happening because we're in survival mode. And it wasn't until you're starting to come out of survival mode that some of people's personality really started to come out. Because we weren't in that, just that survival of feeding, eating, comforting, you know, Maslow's lower hierarchy needs sort of thing. We were actually able to express more. So it was a really nice walk out.
And how does it end?
Oh, so you walk, the whole reason they make you walk out is because they can't get the buses into the Sahara where you are, to be honest. So you walk out.
Charity.
Yeah, charity, yeah. So you walk out and there's a little village and there's the buses there to take you to Wawazati, and which is a 5.5 hour coach trip. And then you're in a hotel, and then we spend 2 nights in the hotel. So you go back to the hotels and, you know, obviously the first thing you're going to do is shower. You know,
what was that like?
Oh, it was really good. You know, it was, but it was like, you know, the hotels always give you white towels, eh? And there was like bright red afterwards because of the Sahara sands. And I'm going, God, my face, oh, that's right. My face had been exfoliated for the last 7 days with the sand blowing at me because it felt so soft. It was, yeah. And just to have some proper food and a glass of wine and start to feel a little bit normal and start to process it was pretty cool.
It's like a Sahara sort of, they talk about microdermabrasion. It's more macrodermabrasion.
Absolutely.
Getting bead blasted. And then, I mean, you've had quite a journey to get to even the point. I mean, you're not home yet, right? Nah. So then it's on to Paris.
Yeah, then it was on to Paris, which was really cool because one of my best buddies from the UK came over for 4 days, which was great. And, yeah, so I wasn't sure how much I'd be able to walk and what my feet would be like, but they were pretty good. So it was nice to have 4 days doing some touristy stuff and just some normal stuff. And then I flew back to New Zealand on the 15th of October, landing on the 17th of October in MIQ.
So you're 9 days deep, basically.
Yeah.
Can I ask a really nerdy question? What shoes did you run in?
Speedgoats. Hoka, right. And Onyani Speedgoats. Yeah.
And yeah. No problems?
No problems at all. Nothing. No, I mean, I ran in my normal size. So some people go up a size because of the swelling, but your feet don't swell lengthways, they swell widthways. As long as you've got enough, to open the laces, then you're all good. So I had no problem at all. I did throw them away. They just did the event and then they threw them away. But that was mainly because I couldn't be bothered with coming back and saying, yes, yeah. I've run across the Sahara Desert. Yeah,
that's right.
Can you please check them for scorpions?
Yeah.
So it was just easier just to throw them, you know. So,
yeah.
So in MIQ, and, you know, I mean, I booked my MIQ before I left because that's a big question I got asked a lot was, oh, how have you managed to get a place in MIQ, you know, and you were lucky to get one. I made a decision in June when I pretty well thought the race was happening to get online to the system and just keep refreshing and getting my MIQ place. So that's what I did. So I secured it way back in June and I knew I had a place when I came back. I think the annoying thing for me was I landed in Auckland thinking they'll keep me in Auckland probably. Landed in Auckland at 11 a.m. and they said, oh, at 1:30 you're going to Christchurch, you know, and you've just done a long haul flight, you know, via Seoul, and you've got another flight. And then I arrived about 4 o'clock on the Sunday evening in MIQ.
And how's that? How are you coping?
MIQ has been great, you know, to be honest, because it's actually given me more time to process. More time when I don't have to think about anybody but myself. And that sounds really selfish, you know, but it's just nice not to have to think about my businesses, to think about having to look after a house or to walk the dog, or, you know, I can literally, I have a routine, because that's, you know, it's really important when you're stuck in a place like in a hotel room all the time to have that routine. So I've been really consciously processing things. I wrote to every single person that sent me a message and thanked them for the message. And I went onto my melanoma, give a little page and thanked all the donations. So I did some really good admin, as well as just taking time to reread everybody's messages, because they printed them off. It was like telegrams. They printed them off and brought around the tent every night. So you had these bits of paper with all these messages. And I had 150 of my messages, 150 of my people who sent the messages. I didn't even know. You know, I didn't know any of them. So to have that and to be reading through that now, I reread them and it takes me back and it reminds me and it humbles me, you know, that the trail running community got behind me and suddenly they turned me into this legend. And it was like, you know, to me, I just ran across the Sahara Desert, you know, and just fulfilled my dream. But yeah, so MIQ has been good from that point of view. And actually, I've started to write my book, because I'm writing a book about the 2 years. So that's started to sort of formulate, which is really cool. I've got a Q&A session on Tuesday with the Xenia girls. Chloe from Xenia's is doing a Q&A with me on Facebook. So yeah, it's been good to process and good to have things to do.
Yeah, yeah. In a way, it's kind of because usually, I mean, I haven't done anything like that, but when you come back from big events and then you're back at home and suddenly it just seems so alien, and so you're still half there and you're coping with what you saw and what you did there, and yet you're still having to feed the cat and whatever. So in that sense, I guess it's a good reintegration. Yeah. Process.
It's a privilege. Yeah. It's a real privilege to have this time, to be honest with you, because you're right. Yeah. When we finish an ultra, before we know it, we're back at work and it's a distant memory. But this has been really good to allow me to process it and to come to terms with it, because it was survival mode sometimes. It really was. It was pretty brutal out there.
Yeah.
I mean, sorry, Eugene, it's so interesting to hear you say about that. I mean, I agree with Eugene. The first day I'm back at work after an ultra marathon, I am clinically ineffective. Well, yeah. I'm not, but in my head it's like, oh God, what's happening? You know, like, but it's so good. It's so, you know, you could consider the Marathon de Sable with all as part of that. Again, it's that pain of privilege, but it looks like it really took on for so many more reasons. A real kind of the risk was real, and even the risk for you getting to that point with not just what you'd endured with your melanoma, but COVID. It being postponed so many times and then getting to the race and then it just seeming to kick off, you know, it really was existential, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, every day Patrick could read out how many people had dropped out from the night before, you know, and one day, the biggest day, I think, which was after the Dunes, we had 138 people had dropped out, you know, so you go, all by the grace of God, you're not one of those people, you know. You know, two of our tent dropped out. By the middle of day three, we were down to six, and we stayed a tight six. But we lost two, you know, and it hurts, and it's it has a big effect on you, definitely.
Yeah, because you form those bonds, and then they're not there. So
yeah,
you mentioned the fundraising, and you've done an astonishing job for Melanoma NZ as well. Last time we checked, you were well over your goal.
Yeah, so I'd raised $4,500 last time, and then I think with whatever I raised this time, I think it's nearly $8,000. So that's really brilliant. Cool. So yeah. So they've been really good, and they sent messages to me, etc. And yeah, they've been really good, the Melanoma NZ.
Yeah, fantastic, fantastic. Well, one thing we should probably let you get back to your MIQ routine, but from talking to you, it sounds like you're someone who is very kind of methodical and approaches things carefully and has a plan. And I hope you don't mind talking about this, but in the Xenia profile, you've talked about a time in your life when running became too much and you had to figure out a way to live with running, I guess. Do you want to tell us a bit about that?
Yeah, I will.
And how that fits with having to be so methodical and so on over taking on something like this.
Yeah, so in my 30s and 40s, I got really over-addicted to exercise. I got addicted to the feel of it, the release of it, the escapism of it, you know, so much so to the fact that I would cancel social engagements to go for a run or to go to the gym extra, restricting my calories. Part of that was I think, just being in control of it, and then suddenly it controlled me. And also some of it was because I played field hockey, was that one of my coaches said to me, you're too old to be playing at this level. So you go, okay, I'm going to bloody prove you then. I'm not too old to be playing at this level. So it got to a stage where it was really unhealthy, you know. My periods had stopped. I'd lost loads of weight. I was cancelling engagements. So I didn't see anybody really socially apart from playing hockey. My friends got really worried about me. They tried to make an intervention, but I wasn't interested because I didn't see it. And then I got a gallbladder infection, which really knocked me, and I got hospitalised for a bit. And that's when I went, alrighty, this is not good. And like, so I thought, okay, it's like I'm an all or nothing person. So I thought the only way I can do this, like any bad relationship, is I need to finish the relationship and not have anything to do with it. So about when I was about 42, 43, I went, no, that's it, I'm not doing any exercise. Okay, I'm not doing it. I'm not because I was fed up of it controlling me. So I actually stopped. Okay, stopped doing it. And then gradually I missed it obviously, and gradually I wanted to start to introduce it, but on my terms. So it was about the fact that I could go, no, I don't need to do this today, or I'm doing it for me. And that's the main thing. I think what happened was my motivation became intrinsic rather than extrinsic. And that was so key that it was, I'm doing this for me. I'm doing this because I enjoy escaping in the trails and I enjoy that feeling of solitude. You know, I don't run with music, and that's part of me just embracing nature, etc. So it was, but for me, it was about finding that happy balance where it wasn't controlling me. And I had a little bit of a scare, a little bit of a blip when we went into lockdown, you know, guys, because it was like the first lockdown. It was like, I'm training for the MDS. I can't do it. We're in lockdown. So what, I can go 5K radius around my house. You know, there's a 10K loop that's 5K radius from my house. I'll just run that every day. So I ended up overtraining a little bit. I ended up having to go, no, stop, Hazel. You don't need to do this. You don't need to do this running. So, yeah, it was just about setting boundaries for myself. And my brain, to me, is a character in my story. You know, my brain is a voice of reason at times. So I use that for it to say, no, you don't need to do this, or you just do this for yourself. So, yeah, that's...
Having that healthy relationship.
Yeah, it's so important, you know, so, so important.
What an incredible thing to recognise, and how your strengths, you know, like, and I see that through your running, but... And maybe it's because I'm looking in a cloud and it looks like a dinosaur. I mean, I see that, you know, as a nurse. Do you know what I mean? We see so many of our colleagues who just destroy themselves because they don't stop, you know, and it becomes, wow, what a thing to recognize, and so good that you did.
Absolutely.
Incredible. Look, Hazel, this has been such a fantastic conversation, and I feel really privileged to have had it with you. And thank you for sharing your story and the grit and the effort that it took to get to the start line. I mean, we're going to wrap it up, you know, let you get back on to your, you know, demolish your spin bike, which is probably sitting quivering in the corner looking at you. But Hazel Harrison, we'll ask you the question that we ask everyone who comes on Dirt Church Radio. What's been your greatest run ever?
Obviously, I knew that you were going to ask me this, so I did give it some thought. And I actually think that my greatest run ever would be the Unity Ultra that I did, the 51 miles for the 51 victims of the mosque, for many reasons. The privilege of doing that just before the country went into lockdown was unbelievable, and the camaraderie between those 10 people. When we set off from Akaroa and we finished at Hagley Park at the mosque, and seeing the people from the mosque being out there to welcome us in. It was just very, very humbling. And the fact that each mile was dedicated to one of the victims. So for me to be part of that was a real privilege and a real honour. And I think that would be my greatest run ever.
Brilliant. Wow. Thank you, Hazel. As Matt said, this has been a real honour. And thank you so much for sharing your story with us. And yeah, what an incredible, incredible journey. I can't wait to read your book.
You're on.
I'm really looking forward to that.
Thanks, guys.
Brilliant. All right, thanks so much, Hazel.
Thank you.
It's the Holy Trinity. It is. It's the worst. I would not care for Hazel if I was in healthcare. I would turn around and run a mile. Like, she should have an alert by her name. Army, ultramarathon runner, ex-nurse. No.
Yeah.
What a wonderful... Yep. I mean, that conversation was so much more than the sum of its parts, right?
Well,
like, what...
And even just a little bit afterwards, we Googled camel spider.
Yeah. Do us a favour. Right before bed, okay? So get into bed, get nice and warm, have your Milo, do your sleep hygiene, okay? Then get your phone and type in the words camel spider and then hit images. You're welcome.
Yeah. You won't be sleeping.
Yeah. No, you won't be sleeping.
Wow. Anyway, thank you so much, Hazel. We really, really appreciated it.
And thank you very much for tuning in. We're on social media at Dirt Church Radio. You can email us at dirtchurchradio@gmail.com. You can find us on all the podcast platforms. Please like and subscribe if you fancy. Leave a review if you like. And you can download direct from the website, which is dirtchurchradio.com.
Don't forget to send in your greatest runs ever. People love hearing them, and we love hearing them and reading them on the website as well. Do it now. We do have a little bit of a backlog from lockdown. Lots of people enthusiastically sent them in, but we get through them all, fear not, and keep sending them in.
Absolutely. Thanks to our sponsors, Scott Running for the Faster and Cielly. Thank you to our Patreon patrons and Wild Things. Thanks to our editor, Kieran, and we've got another great show lined up for you next week, so please tune in then.
Thanks, Rigby.